Welcome
to church.
Good morning from wherever you may be viewing. Can we welcome you to online worship again? Thank you for joining us in the name of Jesus Christ. His is the invitation, you know, that we're able to respond to every time we meet God and worship. And today we want to give our minds to Jesus' invitation to come and meet a God of incredible generosity. Jesus would point us to his Father, and he says this about him: no good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. No good thing does God withhold. And so we are invited by God the Son to know and also to experience and to delight in the generosity of the living God. And to enjoy that generosity has been the experience of God's people all through time. And on one occasion, that generosity was described, and it's recorded for us in Psalm 31, verses 19 and 20. And on that occasion, just with the experience of the generosity of God's people, this is what they said to God: your goodness is so great. You have stored up blessings for those who honour you. You have done so much for those who come to you for protection. You hide them in the shelter of your presence, safe. So let us, with a willingness, but also with a joyfulness and an expectation, respond to Jesus' invitation to know, to receive, but also then to worship God for a wonderful generosity towards us. And God is generous because the nature of his very character is one of faithfulness. He can do nothing else than be generous to us. So let us enjoy the words of our first hymn that reminds us of that wonderful truth of God's faithfulness in the way that he is good and true and kind and forgiving and gracious and merciful and also generous to us.
Thank you.
greatest of heights to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring.
Dear Lord, as we continue to be challenged by the ongoing pandemic, help us to trust your guidance and to let us feel your presence in our lives today. We share with you all our cares and worries, and we trust that you will take care of us. As we keep our minds and our hearts focused on you, Lord, please allow us to share in your grace whilst thinking of others less fortunate during these difficult times. We pray for those who are sick, and for those families who have lost loved ones. Lord, you are in control of all things, and we pray that the spread of coronavirus across the world will stop soon, and that we will all remain safe. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. Amen.
Let's make greed a virtue. That's the bold declaration that Gordon Gekko, the star of the 1987 movie Wall Street, makes in a speech to the greats of Wall Street. He confidently states to them that greed is good, the little clip we'll just watch to refresh our memories. But in that, what he is doing is turning a vice into a virtue.
The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind. And
so what about greed? Well, greed is a tyrant. Greed is a tyrant with an insatiable appetite for money and power, and that insatiable appetite, it consumes lives. For example, it consumes lives through modern slavery to give the West cheap goods. Greed is a tyrant that consumes more than lives, it consumes people's souls, because it makes a promise it just can't keep, and the promise it makes is that stuff gives life meaning and purpose. And perhaps is it not true that with all that has gone on in COVID-19, that particular lie has in a way been exposed, because we've been discovering that life actually is so much more important than the stuff that we amass. So greed and generosity, they are two opposite words, two opposite belief systems, two opposite sets of attitudes and behaviours that actually ask the same big questions about life. What is the purpose of life? Money, stuff, or something else? What is life all about? Acquiring things, possessions, or something else? Well, it was big questions like these that the thousands of people carried in their own hearts whenever they milled around Jesus in the events that Luke has recorded for us in chapter 12 of his gospel. Jesus is making his way through that crowd. He is having different conversations with different people. And one man, he shouts out. And look, he writes down what that encounter was. And so we're going to listen to it as it is read for us now, from verse 13 through to 21 of Luke 12. And as we listen, let's invite the Spirit of God to help us to hear what Jesus' word is saying to us for our lives, for our belief, and also for the way that we behave today.
The parable of the rich fool. Then someone called from the crowd, "Teacher, please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." Jesus replied, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things as that?" Then he said, "Beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own." Then he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." Then he said, "I know, I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, 'My friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for?' Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God."
So from verses 13 to 15, we see there greed's attractive deception. And as we step into the story together, this man who we discover in a few verses' time is he's a younger son. He's a young brother. And this man, he just comes right out whenever he shouts at Jesus. All the angst and maybe even anger at what his big brother has done to him, it all comes out. Grief at his father's death, it seems to have given way to a real burning injustice. And we know this because he calls out his demand to Jesus, "Please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." Now, Hebrew law in that day was that two-thirds of an estate would go to the oldest brother, and then one-third would go to the younger. And so this young brother's request of Jesus was for Jesus, as a teacher, a rabbi recognized as such, to speak to his big brother. We're not told if big brother was beside him or somewhere close by, but perhaps we could conclude yes, because the young brother, he makes this appeal that Jesus will give a judgment that is going to be heard and then heeded. But Jesus, he answers that appeal, that request, with a question. He says to him, "Friend," a word of warmth. He said, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things?" Now, to arbitrate on a family dispute, it's not of highest importance to Jesus Christ and to his mission. The priority of Jesus' life and mission is to teach about and invite people into the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God views money and possessions and property in a radically better way. Now, the text is silent about how the man received Jesus' question to him. I can't help but wonder, did his eyes roll? Maybe his hackles rose? Maybe his head went down? We don't know. But Jesus, what he immediately does is move the conversation on to the heart of the matter for this young brother. And the heart of the matter for him was actually the matter of his heart towards God. And what Jesus is doing in that question is getting this younger brother to question, what is the goal and therefore the God in his life? Was it the stuff and possessions of an inheritance, or was it a rich relationship with the living God of the Bible? And so Jesus just follows up that question to this friend. He says, "Beware. Don't be greedy for what you don't have. Real life is not measured by how much we own." See, greed, it plants a seed in people's minds. It's a seed that the more they have, the happier they're going to be. But that is a lie. It is. It's an attractive deception. And so Jesus uses an alarm bell word, beware. It's a red flag word about a grave danger. In Jesus' day, the word beware, it meant you really must understand and get your head around how dangerous greed is. Now, if we were to make a survey of the Bible and verses about greed, we would very quickly discover the gravity of greed's deceptive danger. It describes greed as consuming lives with dissatisfaction. It says that greed destroys cheerfulness and contentedness. Describes the way that greed makes people despise other people and even God himself. It describes how greed brings ruin into families, that it brings ruin to reputations, that it brings ruin to a life and ultimately to a soul. So a couple of little applications, maybe just to make at this point, that we need to be aware, that we need to beware of advertising, for example. We need to be aware of that innocent sounding peer pressure from people in our career or maybe friends or even family who are encouraging us to go bigger and get better. And the danger can be that there is a deceptive lie at the heart of that that says, you know, you're not measured by what you are, but you're measured by what you own. And then a second application is that in Jesus' kingdom, God the Father, the Son, the Spirit measures the worth of a person, you and I, by the richness of our relationship with God, not in the stuff that we have or don't have, not in the possessions that we amass. And so we need to deliberately reject that deceptive lie that greed is a good thing. Instead, what we want to do is to build our belief structure and then our behaviours on the truth that Jesus says to this younger brother right at the end of that first encounter. He says, you know, life is not measured by how much you own. So greed has an attractive deception. And then the next part of the story, it shows us that greed also has a ruthless destruction. And when I was thinking about this the other day, an inspiring and really very humbling conversation over coffee one morning came to mind. In that conversation, it was with a guest, and they were sharing a little bit of the story about how they had responded to the prompt that God had given them to step away from the work that they were doing and to step out instead in faith into an unpaid role with a Christian organization. And as I listened to my guest's words, there was such a willing enthusiasm. There was such a degree of faith that shone through, and it especially was so bright whenever they spoke about the money that they had been able to save whenever they'd been previously working. And they just simply said, you know, God provided those finances, and I'm going to be able to rely on those now, because sure, after all, it's God's money, and he would want me to use it to build God's kingdom. And as I read Jesus' parable, that conversation came forcefully back to me, and my thought was, you know, my guess, they really got it about God's kingdom and about that value of generosity. Now, the story that Jesus tells, the parable that he tells about this wealthy farm owner, well, the wealthy farm owner didn't get God's work in his life. He didn't get that God created the ability of the seeds that he sowed to replicate themselves. He didn't get that God had sent along the right weather patterns of rain and dry and sun to make the crops grow and ripen. And as we look at that story about how he speaks to himself, how he thinks about what he's going to do next, there's a few little points that will be helpful if we take time to note them. And the first point is his talk to himself, and he's having this conversation with himself. And his talk to himself was all about his ease and his pleasure and his security. And if you've the text there, you'll easily find what he says: I'll tear down, build bigger, and I'll have the room. And The little point maybe just to pause and think about is whenever we are talking to ourselves about our life and our future and the direction that we want to go, talk about God's place in it as well. We need to talk sensibly. We need to talk biblically to ourselves. And then this man had thoughts. Not only did he talk to himself, but he had thoughts about himself. And his thoughts about himself, they were just selfish. I'll is repeated three times. There was no room for God and his plans and his intentions. And you know, we all have intentions. We all have those thoughts about work, direction for that, for family, for the places that we volunteer in, for a place of service in a church. And as we think to ourselves in these things, well, have we asked God lately what his intentions, what his plans are for us in these places? And then the third little thing to note about this man's conversation and his thinking is the mistake that he makes. Simply put, there was no planning in his life for his eternal destination. His mistake was forgetting that he, like everyone else, faces a judgment day of spiritual reckoning when the question will be asked by the God of the Bible, what did you do with Jesus? Did you trust? Did you obey? Did you follow? Or did you do something else? And so the picture of greed's destruction is sadly painted right at the end of that little bit at the narrative where God says to this rich farm owner, he says, "You fool, tonight you will die. And who will get it all then?" So we move to the last little point of Jesus' teaching, and we do so under the headline of greed's revolutionary alternative, and we find it in verse 21. You know, you have to wonder how that younger brother responded to what Jesus said to him as those words landed into his heart. And we also have to wonder how the crowd who were standing round responded. Were they silenced by the challenge of Jesus' words? I think they maybe were. Because after all, they were having their big questions of life answered by Jesus too. The big questions of what's the purpose of life? Money? Something else? What's life all about? Acquiring stuff or something else? You know, we have to love the way that Jesus ends this parable with such grace in verse 21, because he does set out there the truth of the two destinies that every person faces, hell or heaven, that is eternity without or with God, decided on by who they rely on in this life, be it themselves or Jesus Christ. But the beautiful grace of Jesus' words in verse 21 is his invitation to that rich relationship with God. And he offers that to everyone. That's what his life, the gospel of his life, is about, by inviting people to that relationship, by asking Christ to take, as it were, the driving seat of their life. And whenever a person invites Jesus onto that driving seat of their life, with the handing over of the keys to the car, as it were, we do that. And in the handing over the keys, we're saying, you know, I am sorry for trying to do it on my own. I am sorry that I've tried to live by self. And will you forgive me? And Jesus says, as he takes the keys, yes, of course I will. I'll forgive you. And Jesus, he then helps us to live life. He helps us to live that full life of a rich, deep relationship with God as he helps us to walk with him. as we believe what the Bible teaches. And then that belief, it shapes all our behaviours, and particularly the behaviour that we're thinking about today, that value of God's kingdom of generosity. And generosity is greed's revolutionary alternative. And those who follow Jesus, we can do nothing else but be generous, just like him. Generosity, it is a giving away of love and time and money and possessions and praise and encouragement, just like Jesus does. Generosity, it asks the question, what can I give away? Whereas greed, we know its question, what can I get out of this? And so we want to conclude by going to that place that is the evidence of Jesus' generosity, and that's the cross, isn't it? And as we go to his cross and as we ponder the enormity of his generosity to us, our revolutionary generosity, let us take time just to say yes. Yes, Lord, I want to show this generosity too.
Written on your face, bearing me.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. May that blessing rest and abide with you and those whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen.